Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. We found on the steps this morning a little teardrop earring. It's got black little beads on the inside, look like diamonds around the outside edge. If they're real, it's mine. But does this belong to anybody? If so, just raise your hand and I'll bring it to you. It's an oval. Al keeps raising his hand back here. That's your hippie days, Al. This probably belonged to the curtains that hung in your closet right here. Praise the Lord. Well, if you're missing an earring, I have it. How's that? Praise the Lord. It is indeed a pleasure to be able to graduate some men this morning from the program, from Good Samaritan, and also from Battle Zone. And Battle Zone is it's a class that is taken, and you can get your coach certificate and captain certificate and all of these. And it's really a tight little bond that you get with a group of men. And we're getting ready. We're going to start it with the women soon. How many in here have been through Battle Zone and really appreciate it? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Well, it's good. And so I'm first going to give out the Battle Zone certificates, and then the ones that are graduating, I'll have them continue to stand up here. But Jason Waring, come on up. Praise the Lord. It's your captain certificate.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you, Pastor.
Proud of you, man. Bless you, bless you. Amen. Now this one, well, I'll give the other one first, and then I'll get a special one this morning. Mr. Donahue, Cody, come on up. Officially, you're now a player. Amen. And you're a good man. You're doing a fabulous job, and I am proud of you. And I'm really proud of you. I look at I all I get on my computer are logs of how everybody's doing. And you're doing well. Keep it up. Get your feet in there and just start gripping really hard and going forward, my friend. I'm very proud of you. Congratulations. Amen. You can stand up here too. Okay? The last one, this is a great pleasure for me. This guy has a testimony that'll just rock your world. People really prayed for him. And I'll never forget when he first came. I got to know a little bit about him and where he was from, and all I could do was just pray that God would do something very special in this man's life. I would like to give his whole testimony, but this probably is not the time. I'm so proud of him. He is now over one of our ranches, and I'm very, very proud of him. He now has his coach's certificate, so I want Riley Chapman to come on up. Where are you, Riley?
Thank you.
I love you too, man. Stand up here with them because I'm going to ask you to pray in a little bit. It really is a privilege, you guys, if you knew where people came from and what God was doing in their life, it would just blow you away. And Riley is just one of those people that will just make you cry if you know anything about him. So, we have some testimonies this morning. I'm going to ask for Jason and Cody's family. If you're here today, come on up and join them. Would you do that? Stand behind them if you would. Come on. Amen. They have a lot of support, don't they? And that's what it takes. So, Cody, I'm going to have you go first. I want you to give your testimony and be bold about it. Your hands are full.
I just want to say, or I guess it's a confession in the Bible. It's that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Right in the mic.
I just want to say thank you to Padula and Pastor Tim for giving me a chance to better my life.
There you go.
And I want to say happy Mother's Day to all you mothers out there, I guess. And thank you.
Amen. You want to introduce your family?
My mom Heather and my sister Shelby and my mom or my grandma Edna and my stepdad Danny.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Cody. Okay, Jason, come on up, brother. Make sure to introduce your family too.
Hi, I'm Jason. I have my mother, my dad, my grandma up here, and all my brothers.
Amen.
I just want to start off by saying Happy Mother's Day to all the moms out here. I would like to read a scripture out of 1 Timothy. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all exception, that Jesus Christ came into this world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. I just want to say that throughout life, I was always trying to find something. I was always trying to fill a void, whether it was with drugs or violence or women or whatever it was. And no matter what I did, I could never fill that void. But now that I've found Jesus Christ and accepted him as my Savior, there's no longer that void. It's amazing, and all honor and glory goes to God for that fact. I just want to thank Riley, Pastor Tim, all the facilitators and administrators in this program for just it being able for me to come here and grow and build a relationship with Christ. Thank you, and I love you all.
Praise the Lord. I'm proud of you. Riley, come on up. Congregation, if you'll stand, we're going to have Riley lead them in prayer this morning. This is a victory, you guys. You know, the devil thought that he had you guys for a while. Did you know that? But you know, when I came out of surgery, there's this black nurse that came out, and he stood there for a minute, and the way my wife does it really good, but he says, you know what? The enemy did not get this one today. And I want to tell you guys the same thing. The enemy did not get you. God has you, and you need to stay in Christ, and we're going to pray over you, because now the mission field really starts. So, Riley.
Father, we come so humbly and thankful, God, for your goodness, your grace, and your mercy in our lives. I pray, God, that as these two brothers graduate today, that this just be the beginning of their journey, that the 60 days in the ranch be nothing more than a time in which a seed was planted. And I pray that from here on out, through the congregation, the power of your Holy Spirit, the watering of your word, that these men are grown into mighty trees of righteousness, Father, that they would bear fruit which is eternal, and that their lives would reflect your character, your principles, your glory. We trust you, God, that all things work together for our good to those who are called according to your purpose and do love you. I thank you for these men. Lord, your life in them is what we want to see lived, and we thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, brother.
Thank you.
Thank you. Amen and amen. We okay? Okay. Like, what have we missed? Okay. Praise the Lord. Mothers, if you're here today, and you have a child that's 2 years old and younger, will you stand? A child that's 2 years old or younger. Go ahead. They're starting to, okay? Just the mothers. Steve stood up. I noticed. She's in the back, standing up for her. All right. Well, actually, if she's out there, you may want to. Okay? If your child is 1 year old or younger, then remain standing. 1 year or younger. Ooh, got some young ones. If your child is 11 months and younger, remain. 10 months and younger, remain. 9 months and younger? Ooh, you guys got to get together. You have the same. 8 months and younger? 7 months. 6 months. 5 months. 4 months. 3 months. 2 months. 1 month. Now watch it. My daughter's gone too? She left, huh? Okay. You already sat down. Did I miss it? 3 months? Okay. Christina is the only one standing. How many ladies in here are pregnant? Raise your hand if you're pregnant. Aaron, you're going to make us a lot of money, buddy. Okay, in the first service, there was even some ladies in here that were pregnant. We have a lot of babies. Tremendous youth group coming up. Amen?
Amen.
Everybody knows Christina's got one. It's a little over a week old. It's a week yesterday. Week of 3 days? Okay. So, congratulations. I love you, girl. Praise the Lord. Amen. Youngest baby. Beautiful baby, by the way. Okay. If you are a mother here that has four or more children, stand up. Okay. Isn't that cool? Okay. How about five or more? Remain standing. Six or more? Oh, six was a good number for people. Seven or more? Boom, boom. Whoa! All four of them sat down at six and seven. Okay, praise the Lord. Give them a hand, you guys. How many of the women that are here today have your children with you? Stand up if your children are with you. Isn't that cool? You don't have to have all of them. You got, we'll make sure she stays in church too. I want to speak to the women that are standing right now. I want to congratulate you a little bit because in the culture that we live in today, one of the hardest things for moms to do is to be able to take their children and somehow instill righteousness within your children and have something really happen that just adheres them to you, to where they'll follow you right into the house of the Lord. God bless you, mothers, and continue to be good mothers and watch what God can do. Amen? Because God is good. Amen. You can have a seat if you'd like. Now, boy, I'm some days. It is important today that we honor our moms. My mom was in the first service. My sister honored my mom in the first service. My mom had four children. My mom's childhood was absolutely rotten to the core. My mom's real mother died 3 hours after my mom was born in childbirth with my mother. Her father did things to her that were absolutely awful until my dad was able to intercede and get her out of that house. And, of course, he married her. She's had four children, and everything that she has been through, when she got saved, she was completely converted. Her heart was converted. Her children followed her. Her children are saved today. Her 23 grandchildren are saved today. Her great-grandchildren are following after Jesus today. And something happened in a life where somebody decided that as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And she did it. And boy, my mom, I would honor her till the day's end. We went out to dinner, Cindy and I, last Thursday night with somebody in the congregation. And there were four of them there, a mom, dad, and two adult children were also there. And as we were eating, I noticed things. As soon as we were done eating, the children, adult children that were also there, got up, picked up the plates, went in the kitchen, and as the parents and us were talking, all of the dishes were clean and everything, we could all go into the other room and sit down and have fellowship. Let me tell you something, what I saw. I saw two children that honor their folks. They honored them so much that the folks never had to ask anything at all. The children found it a joy to work together. They got up, went into the kitchen, and I watched them work together as they smiled at each other and giggled at each other and had a good time in the kitchen. And the parents never said a word. And I want to just praise God that there are still those people out there. Because I will guarantee you, if my mom needs something, my mom's going to get it, what she needs, because I love her. She doesn't have to tell me what to do. If I see something that I know that needs to be done, I do it because I love her. Praise the Lord. And so God bless all of you that are really honoring your mothers today. Thank you so much, brother. So I really want you to feel that too. So I'm going to have, if you're a father today and you are 70 years old and older, would you stand a father? Boom, 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 boom. Thank you. 75 or older. Anybody else? I don't know what you guys, but here's what I'm going to do. Chuck, can you take these roses and get them out of the packages? Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to ask all these men, if you don't mind, the elder men that are here today, and I think it would be their pleasure if the women stand up. I'm going to have these elder men. In fact, why don't you, the ones that are 70 years old and older, come on up, would you? Come on up with me up here, if you would. Come on up. Not how you feel, how old you really are. Okay? Chuck, if you'll give a bundle of those to each one of these men, after they are all up here, I'm going to have the mothers stand one more time, and then I'm going to have these men give each one of you a rose in honor of Mother's Day today, and it's going to be a pleasure to do so, I believe. Okay? There's one. My brother. Ladies, if you'll stand, the mothers, we're going to make sure that all of the mothers get a rose today. Here, you guys can. Yeah, okay. We'll open up some others and hand it to these gentlemen. Thank you very much for helping us this morning, gentlemen. It's a privilege to have you here helping us. Hey, John, can you do me a favor? Is there doing that? And clean up after him really quick. Praise the Lord. While they're doing that, I want to make sure that every mother gets one. Isn't it a privilege to have some of the men help us this morning? God bless us. Some of them are even visiting today. So, Adela, right in the middle. Would you come up here, sweetheart? This is Adela, for those that don't know. She's our secretary at the church. And I want to give you this rose. And I also want you to talk a little bit. And I know that I was going to do this today. But one of the things when it comes to mothers, there's a certain amount of people in this congregation that suffered greatly as a mom, thinking that their whole family would be lost and gone. And I'm going to ask Adela to give a little testimony on how the Lord reestablished her relationship with her children as a mother. And so I want you to hear this testimony. I love you, girl, and introduce your children too.
I'm so sorry. First of all,
press that button.
My two children, I have Kayla Crawley, will you just go and stand up? And then I have Madison Riggs. Those are my two baby girls. Yeah. And I also have my son Joseph Riggs as well. And so, you know, God has just worked so mighty in my life. You know, I always hold fast to just how grateful I am where my life is today, because our life was just complete garbage. There's so many children out there that suffer from, you know, parents that are run by addiction, and Satan just loves to keep you down in your shame and in your guilt and thinking that there's no way you can ever get out. And I remember Kayla, I had Kayla when I was, got pregnant with Kayla when I was 15 and a half. I was 16 years old when I had her. And in a way, we grew up together. That little girl has suffered so much from my addiction. There'd be times she would go to bed at night and wake up and I would be gone for weeks on end. And then that carried through her whole life. And I tell you, God has really just blessed children with unconditional love. And they don't have the static and the distractions that we do. And I just praise the Lord for that. She's been through so much, going in and out of drug houses with me. And then I got pregnant with Madison and Joey. And then I thought I'd clean up my life a little bit. But to me, that was just doing drugs behind closed doors. I went through so many different seasons with my drug use, you know, and when I came to the ranch, I was radically saved. The Lord really called me to Him. I surrendered everything to Him. He took my life and He changed my heart completely. And while I was in the program, I saw miracle after miracle, not only in my life, but in my brother's life. He went through the ranch. We got to stand on stage together, which really doesn't happen. Together and graduate and profess what the Lord has done in our lives. And in that time, my daughter Kayla came to the Lord. My other children were a little bit more not forgiving. It took Madison a long time to even trust me and to even receive any love from her. She was still very hardened about things. And then I went through, graduated. I just really wanted to follow God. I know that that's what He called me to do. And then we came through little bumps. You know, my brother, he kind of left and did his thing. And then Kayla left and did her thing. I still wasn't blessed yet to be a mom to Kayla or Madison and Joey. But my family was my family here in Christ. And I remember standing right over there and that's that song, though no one will follow, I will still follow. And I know that when we sing these songs, but it's something when it really touches your heart to know what you're really singing. And I remember saying that and I thought, am I going to follow you even though nobody else in my family right now is here with me? Am I going to still follow you? And that's when I made the commitment, yes, I will still follow you. I will still be here. I will still follow you. And I stayed the course. I prayed for my family daily, night and day, just always praying for. And it was right there, too, when I got down and I really prayed and the Lord really comforted me. And He did. He told me that they're going to be okay, that He's got them. And so just recently, it was like 2 years went by and, you know, our family was kind of detached. We would come together on Sundays, but it just wasn't, you know, I mean, we'd come together, but it just was, something was still missing. I remember my mom had said, Jacob had told her, I don't know what it is. I can't connect with Adela yet still, because there was still like a little block in there. But up until a few months ago, it's just been so crazy because God had just totally, my daughter, Kayla, started coming around. She knew things were happening in her life, that she had to make some decisions. And she started coming around, and we were sitting on the couch, and she goes, Mom, I have something to tell you. And I'm like, oh, okay. And she goes, ugh, but I want to rededicate my life to the Lord. And I tell you, the Lord came in like a mighty wind in her life. Her life has completely changed. She was just in the office the other day saying, you know, she just can't believe how much her life has changed in just 3 months. And with her coming forward, I have my other daughter, Madison, who, you know, is starting to come around, and she's seeing all this. And she, a couple weeks ago, goes, Mom, I want to get baptized. And so it's just like, and my brother, I mean, we're Thank taking you, Lord. Up a whole row right now when it was just me right here. And all glory goes to God. God is just such an amazing God. He is a God of restoration. He is a God. He is the God in our lives. And so, you know, I just tell everyone, just hold on to hope. You never know when that moment's going to be. I mean, I stand around and I think, is this really happening right now? I'm just so overwhelmed, but yet this incredible peace from heaven is just over me like, I gotcha, you know? And you never know when that moment's going to be when the Lord just delivers, and it's just so amazing. And I just give all the glory to my Father in heaven. He's just such a good God, and I'm so thankful for this day. And I tell you, I stay so grateful for the very first moment that the Lord blessed me and gifted me with salvation and a new way of living and just a new life, and I'm just so grateful for that. And so thank you so much.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Isn't that exciting? Families being restored. If you're a widow this morning, could I have you do me a favor? If you're a widow this morning, could I have you stand? Any widows that are here? I know LaGrita is in the back. Thank you. Anybody else? Any other widows in here at all? Okay. AJ, could you do me a favor? Could you give? I want LaGrita in. Thank you. You know, the widows have a very special place in the church because the Lord told us that they have a special place. We need to do our best to be able to pray for them and take care of them. LaGrita in the back, I love you so much. God bless you guys. Jerry Baker was an elder in our church, deacon in our church, passed away. And LaGrita, you're very faithful. You're still here. And God loves you. We love you, and thank you for everything. For all of you that the mamas in here that don't have the daddies here anymore to help you. So, I want to take just a couple minutes to talk to you about the heart of a mom that comes from God. My wife is in the back row there. Of course, she's been coming to church as long as I have, and we've been married for 36 years. And as a mama, I've watched her be a mom. Dads and moms are different people. I don't know how many of you recognize the difference, but in our home, there's a big difference. Cindy's always been the type when our kids get hurt. Cindy's always the type that just runs up and, oh, let me kiss. She wants to kiss on it, and any mamas in here like that? They just want to kiss the hurts of their kids. Wow, not many of it. Raise your hand higher. You scared me for a minute. Okay. It's like, no wonder we got problems around here. Nobody cared about our kids. Cindy's always been the type they really wanted to put a Band-Aid on it, you know, because it hurt. Give it a kiss. I was a little different. It's like, as long as your limb is still on there and you're not bleeding out, you're probably doing pretty good. When my kids would come up and they'd be hurt and they'd have a little scratch on their finger, they'd always, if they came up to me, that's how they talk. They can't, when they're hurt like that. I'd flick them in the finger. Or I'd take the finger and I'd squeeze it. Just to let them, you're fine. And we kind of raised up the boys like that, just, come on, let's be a man. Let's get over this. Where Cindy was the type that really wanted to just kiss on it, and you're going to be okay, and I'll never forget. Jeremiah, we got him a little 50, a YZ50. Is that what it, yeah. And our driveway, anybody's been up our driveway, you know it's a wide driveway, and there's ramp kind of on both sides, and you take the motorcycle and try to jump our driveway, one side to the other. This little kid. And I'll never forget, he had a helmet on, and that was it. We had a gravel driveway, And he took that little YZ and phew, we got it on camera. And when he's going over, you can see the motorcycle here, and then here, and then here. And then touchdown. Boom! Wipe out. Wiped out on the other side of the drive. Now here's the way that the men handle these things. Because as soon as you wipe out, the men are there going, yes! That was good! Good! Wipe out! Let me see the blood! That was cool! Because we don't want them to just to freak out. We don't want them to, oh, I'm dying! Okay? Moms see those things, and the mom almost dies. Now I got to take care of both of them. Mom, of course, wanting to run out, and the kid, he doesn't know what to do at first. Okay? They kind of look at both, and they don't know. Dad's all proud of him at the time, going, come on! So he's kind of giving that proud look, going, our kids were kind of raised like that. They were, the boys are, you know, kind of the tough boys. Don't be crying for no reason. But moms, we need your heart. We need your heart involved in the children. And I've watched Cindy do that over the years, where her heart just grabs hold of each one of the children. Her and Gracie's probably spend 3-4 hours a day with each other. Still. Just hanging out. And I'm glad for that. I'm glad that Gracie has a mom that wants to and is willing to do that. All the boys, they all respect their mother. I'll never forget Jeremiah one time decided he was going to give his mama that look. Didn't say anything. Just gave her the look. And he found himself on the other side of the room. One time. That's all it took. And after that, he never gave her no look. And I'll tell you, but to this day, my children respect their mom. If you don't believe me, try giving mom a bad look when the kids are around. They protect their mother when it comes to that. They honor their mother when it comes to that. My children were raised to honor their mother, to respect their mother. In the culture that we live in today, one of the things that is absent from our culture is the respect for the parents and the respect that they have for their mother. Why is that? Why do we not have respect? Yes, it's bred out there, but even within the church, it was over a year and a half ago, a couple years ago, that a lady was in my office with her daughter. And all the daughter had to do was one time she called her mom a name in my office. And all I had to do, I stood up and I said, I don't think so. That ain't going to happen here. And you know, she backed down. But in my office, you are not going to do that. That is your mother. And I think that all we really need is more people backing up what God says. When somebody needs to honor their parents, we need to tell them. You need to knock it off, and you need to honor your parents. You need to honor your mother. A mother's love is so forgiving. So forgiving. Do you know, when it comes to mom, what can your children do ever in your life that'll just make you give up? Yeah, I'm not going to love you anymore. A mother's love is so forgiving. Do you know where that comes from? It comes from God. Some of you, this congregation's been through a lot. Some of you have mothers and fathers that were drunks, they were addicts, they were just out there. But let me tell you something. A lot of that is because of shame. It's because of shame. The mothers that are walking all over America, living under bridges, waking up beside people that they don't even know, needles in their arm when they go to bed at night and can't wait to put a needle in their arm when they get up because they can't stand the day. Why is that? Because they live and walk in the shame of their doings. Man, moms, Somebody needs to wrap their arms around some of these people. We've tried to spend our life doing that. It's just wrapping our arms around them and just telling them, God loves you. No matter what you've done, God loves you. God can repair you. God can send you out there to do great and wonderful things. And one of the first things that you need to do, Mom, is reconcile with your children. My children will never love me again. I gave up my children. The abortion rate, I would give you the stats as far as the highest rates of abortion come from, believe it or not, the homosexual community. The second one is the addiction community. If a person is an addict and everything, they sleep with somebody that they shouldn't have slept with, whatever, they end up getting an abortion. So now the abortion rate starts to climb. And now we have to deal with the mom who aborted their child later. And the shame and the hurt that's involved with that. Mothers today need to be honored. Mothers today need to be embraced. We need to try to pick you back up to where you can really be a good mom again. We don't need to fall. The women in America, do you understand the importance of the moms in America? And we're just throwing it away. The heart of a mom is caring, it's discerning, it's helpful, it's persistent, it's full of faith. You're expected to do everything to be a super mom. You have to be a nurse, a doctor, counselor, caregiver. You need to function with very little sleep. They need to be up before the kids, go to bed after them. And then, if you're not a single mom, you're expected to put on a romantic wife hat and turn around with your husband. They're expected to do it all with a smile and the sweetest attitude. Being a mom is not an easy thing. I know many moms that feel undervalued, unappreciated, unrecognized. Some of them feel even hated. Well, from your kids, you don't recognize all that you do. From your husbands, you don't appreciate all that you do. And from a society who doesn't even value the place of a mother, I want to say that we love you and happy Mother's Day. Mothers also want to rejoice in their children. So as mothers, the mothers that are here today, isn't it a good thing to watch your children do something where you can rejoice with them and love on them? In Proverbs 23 and 25, it says, thy father and thy mother shall be glad, and she that bare thee shall rejoice. Yes, it's hard. But God designed it to where you could rejoice with your children. You could rejoice in your children. You need to put the effort in just rejoicing with them, making them feel secure. 90% of all addicts come from divorced homes. That's the single most common denominator. 76% of the women in the five northern counties that are in there for drugs have been raped or molested by somebody that they thought loved them. We lose our security. Once the security is gone, now we're searching everywhere to try to get that security back. And the only thing we're stuffing inside of us is shame. Now listen to the most important thing that a mother can give, and this is out of Isaiah 66 and 13. It's also the same thing that Jesus, when he was leaving, said. The Holy Spirit is going to come. I'm going to give you a comforter. And he calls the Holy Spirit a comforter, where we can feel comfort in our lives. A mama always helps their kids to feel comfortable. Tucking the kids in at night. When our kids were little, Cindy'd tell me, she'd go, I'll be upstairs in 1 minute. I just got to tuck the kids in. An hour later, she's tucking the kids in, praying with them, reading the word with them. Sometimes longer, she'll come upstairs, and inside I'm like, what about me? Hello? And yet, can I complain? What do you want me to say? Stop praying with those kids. Would you quit reading scripture with those kids? No, I'm not going to say that. Okay? I know better than to go that way. So I want Cindy pour comfort and security into our kids. Now, as a dad, I'd like to be able to say, man, I did this too, and I did this too, but I have to recognize, Cindy, that you are a super mom, and that you poured that into our children. In Isaiah 66 and 13, it says, as one whom his mother comforteth, so will I comfort you, and ye shall be comforted in Jerusalem. So the Lord is saying, just like I would send something to you to comfort you, or even me myself in my capacity, he compares that to what a mother does to her children. You make them feel comfortable. Our kids are comfortable in our house. Our kids are comfortable talking to us about whatever they need to talk to us about. Who instilled all of that? My wife did. My wife did. Now, I would like to believe, again, that I helped, but she was the one that really put it in their lives. In Matthew chapter 15, 21 through 28, it'll be up here, but you can, by the way, it's raining. What a surprise. We had summer last year. It was on a Thursday. Matthew 15, starting with verse 21. I'm doing this. I'm going to surprise you a little bit. Stephen and I were talking. He says, I reckon it's hard to be able to come up with a sermon that's different on all these subjects all these years. I've been preaching over 30 years. And he's right. It's hard. I mean, everybody knows what are you going to preach on today? It's Mother's Day. What do you think I'm preaching on? Okay. Resurrection Day. What do you think he's preaching on? Got to come up with something different, don't I? Well, this is a little different. I'm going to show you the heart of a mother. In Matthew 15, let's start verse 21. Then Jesus went thence and departed into the coast of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan. So she was a Canaanite. She came out of the same coast and she cried unto him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. Now let's stop there for a minute. Let's look at the heart of this woman. First of all, the Canaanite women were not, the Jewish community despised them. And so now you have one that runs up to him. And she's trying to make a plea. Her daughter's the one that's vexed with the devil, but she says, have mercy on me. Do you know that mothers share the burdens with their children? When their children are going through something, the mother goes through the suffering for their child. When a child is going through something, the mom feels it. Feels it. This woman is feeling it. And her daughter, she's standing now before the Lord, and she has great discernment. Nowadays, we call it mental problems. We give them a pill, hope it goes away. She was discerning enough to know that her daughter was actually vexed by the devil. But he answered her not a word, and I want you to understand that we're going to get into this cultural things of how he was going to the Jews, and he got somebody else that's coming up trying to do something. And the Lord's going to make her an example. He's going to go ahead and he's going to play with the culture that was there. But watch what happens in the end of this. But he answered her not a word, and his disciples came and they besought him, saying, send her away, for she crieth after us. In other words, she's annoying. She just, help me, have mercy on me, have mercy on me, get rid of her. He is interrupting what's going on here. But he answered and said, and he's going to play into the culture here. I'm not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So I'm going after a certain group here. Then came she. She didn't go away. And she worshiped him, saying, Lord, help me. You know how many women keep on trying, keep on trying, and keep on trying. I'm not going to let my daughter be vexed by this devil. I need to get help. And this man is where I need to go. I've seen him do it before. I've seen him deliver demons out of people. I've seen him heal people. And I'm not letting go until I get what I came for. Because I know that he cares. I've watched him. But he answered and said, it's not meet to take the children's bread and cast it to the dogs. Because he knew that this was going to be a response. Listen to this. And she said, truth, Lord. That's true. Yet, the dogs eat of the crumbs which fall from the master's table. What humility. Have mercy on me. My daughter's in trouble. I can't fix her. Nobody can fix her. But you can fix her. Have mercy on me. Because she may be vexed with the devil, but I am vexed with trying to deal with it. I love her so much that I will stand before you, I will chase you down, and I will stay as humble as I can through the process, but I'm going to be right behind you, and I'm not letting go. This is where I think he blows his disciples away. And I love it. I love how Jesus, he plays into the culture a lot. And then at the very end of it, then all the disciples are able to turn around and go, that was good. Like the woman at the well. I always get a kick out of that one. I've been in that circumstance so many times where I wanted to go help somebody, but I'm with this group and they're not going to understand it. So get rid of that group so I can go help somebody. Jesus was with his disciples. And he's got to pass by the way of Samaria, and he knows that there's this woman that's going to be up there. So what does he do? Chases off his disciple. Hey, go grab something to eat. And he goes, and he meets this woman, Samaritan woman. Yikes. Another one that's despised. We don't talk to them. Jesus did. Jesus did. But he knew that his disciples, they weren't going to be able to handle that very well. And so rather than deal with his disciples and the Samaritan woman, he sent the disciples off so he could deal with the Samaritan woman. She got the victory. And now, here's another one. And guess who's going to get the victory? So then Jesus, after she said that, I'm just here, I will participate in the crumbs off of the master's table because they're good enough for me and they're good enough to heal my daughter. Jesus answered and said to her, O woman, great is thy faith. The disciples are hearing this. Great is thy faith. Be it unto thee even as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole in that very hour. That's huge. Canaanite woman. Not respected at all. In the very end, she is the one that gets the victory. Her daughter is suffering. So she is suffering too. She says, have mercy on me, herself. She cares so much. There's so much empathy that's going on there. That her daughter is demon possessed. The mothers are persistent. They keep going after it. It's exactly what she did. Mothers don't want to stop until they get the healing for their children. Mothers are discerning. She didn't say, I need to go to health and welfare. My daughter's got mental issues. She says, my daughter is vexed of the devil. Discernment. One thing that's really lacking in the church today. The devil can run in and out of our churches today, and we call it mental problems. And I really believe that the devil just plays all over this culture. Inside of their hearts and inside of their minds. and they need to be stopped. The guy that shot me, you call it whatever you want. They say it was mental issues, and they sent him down. Bottom line is, it's not a mental issue. He was in the middle of meditating when he got a hold of that thing. He could tell you the time that he got a hold of it, and it grabbed a hold of him. And again, I will say it, I am not the victim of that shooting. He is the victim. The Lord is going to make me a victor over this, and he needs victory over what he's going through mentally. It's not a mental issue. This is a spiritual issue. It always has been a spiritual issue, and we need to start addressing these things as spiritual issues. In Isaiah 49 and 15, it says, can a woman forget her sucking child, that she should not have compassion on the son of her womb? Yea, they may forget, yet I won't forget you. So he makes it a point to say, the mothers build up this thing with their children. Not only do they hold them for 9 months, but after they're born, now you watch face to face while your child is nursing on you. Face to face, eyeball to eyeball. You just watch this child and you gaze into each other's eyes for a long period of time. And there is nothing greater for you. There's nothing greater than your child than to look into the eyes of each other for that period of time. Later on in life, you'll still do it. And children need to understand, your mothers absolutely love it if you look them dead in the eye and say, I love you. Dead in the eye. All of my mom's children love her. We're not ashamed to look her right in the eye. Say, Mom, I love you so much. So the Lord builds this little idea that there's so much comfort with a mom. So much compassion with the mom. Just like the mom will never forget what it was like. He says, Jesus says, they may. Something may happen to them where there is a breach. But I will never forsake you. Never. There's so much where he compares himself to the mom. The mom gives you comfort. I'll give you comfort. The mom loves you. She's the one that nursed you and everything. And I'm going to be there even more so for you, just like your mother. God has created the hearts of moms to be caring. And there's so much examples in Scripture of this. And I think that we had time today. And of course, I always have, just in case, I always have pages of notes. But I'm going to go take all of this back to Ephesians 6:1. Children, obey your parents in the Lord. For this is right. I like the way that he says that. All of you know right from wrong. All of you know good and bad. Is there anybody in here that doesn't know right from wrong? You say, well, there's some people dealing on their culture. No. I believe that there's a light that lighteth every man that cometh into this world, and I believe it gives them the discernment to know right from wrong. You could put them, I tell everybody, I don't mind putting anybody on a polygraph. $200, we can do it. We could do up to 200 people on this if we actually set this in motion to prove a point. Because I tried to prove a point to the state. The state believes that people have mental issues and they don't know right from wrong. I say put them on a polygraph and I'll prove to you that everybody knows right from wrong. Everybody knows. Here, the Lord says, you know that it's right. Obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and mother, which, and here it is the first commandment with a promise. It has a promise that goes with it. If you do not honor your mother and your father, then something's going to happen to your life. Just know it. That's why, before we leave today, I'm going to be asking all of you. The mothers have to be restored to their children. Righteously restored to their children. It said that it may be well with thee and thou mayest live long on the earth. This needs to play out in all of our lives. Now, for the most part, who is it when a child is hurt or when he's lost? He always says, I want my mommy. I want my mommy. My kids used to say that when I picked them up. I want my mommy. And then something. Jeremiah was acting up at the church we went to in Loma Linda. And we were just going to take him out of the church. And he knew, you act up, I'm going to whoop you. And so we were in the church, started acting up, grabbed a hold of him, started taking him to the restroom. So I'm holding him, heading for the restroom, as he's hollering, don't kill me, Dad! Don't kill me! Don't hurt me! What are these people even thinking right now? Is he going to go to the bathroom and kill his kid? Does he beat him on the side? Man. All that did is make me want to kill him. You keep it up, man. You keep it up. Matthew 15 and 22 says, behold, a woman who came out of the same coast, and she cried unto him, have mercy on me. How many of you actually cry to the Lord to have mercy on you when you're going through it? Have mercy on me. Do we always, having mercy on you makes a point to the Lord. It's not, Lord, take care of this. Lord, take care of this. Lord, fix him. Fix that. Fix them. Fix her. Fix. We're always asking the Lord to do all that. Versus this woman said, have mercy on me. Mercy is a very interesting subject to go to the Lord with. Have mercy on me. Mercy is something that you really don't deserve. So she's going before the Lord with a hurt child going, I don't deserve this, man. I know I don't deserve it. I've done wrong. I didn't do it right. Whatever's going on with this child, maybe I had something to even do with it. So have mercy on me. Even though I don't deserve this at all, I feel it. Something's wrong here. She wants mercy. How many of you cry mercy versus just fix the problem, Lord? Man. Ephesians 6:12 says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Had nothing to do with the person, the physical person that was there. She understood that we're not wrestling with this. And you're the person that's the king over all of it. And this needs to be stopped. And he stopped it. Now I know that there's a lot of hurting ladies that are here today. And I know that you've been through a lot. Some of you, I can't even imagine what it is to lose a child. But I want you to have healing. I want you to have a lot of healing. I'd like to close. And I want to close with a couple scriptures that I want to give you. Because I know that some of you are really hurting because your families have been divided, been messed up because of relationship problems, and that needs to be restored. In Mark chapter 7 and verse 25, it says, for a certain woman whose young daughter had an unclean spirit heard of him, came and fell at his feet. She wanted to find the help that her daughter needed. She begged the Lord. There's an unclean spirit here. Take care of it. Evil things are all over the place. And the devil, to have his way and what he really wants to do, the first thing that he wants to do was absolutely destroy your family. He wants to divide the mothers from their daughters, the fathers from their children, the children and the father. The enemy knows that if he can divide it, then he could beat. And I want you to understand this. It's a spiritual thing that is going on. We are tools that allow the enemy to come in and help do it. And I want to say to the ones that have stuck it out and the ones that have prayed and got your families back together, I am so proud of you for realizing that this is a spiritual thing. And I'm proud of you that you have got this thing and said, I rebuke this in the name of Jesus, and I'm going to rely on God to completely restore our families. I'm proud of you for doing it. God's going to see his way through it, and watch what happens. It'll be okay. In closing today, I'd like, if that same power that rose Jesus from the grave. Mothers, pay attention today, because I'm going to have them play that song. No matter what you've been through, my mom was beat and raped by her father. My mom's real mom died 3 hours after having my mom, after birthing her. And her childhood was an absolute wreck. And then she met Jesus. Did everybody get that? It was a spiritual thing. See, the enemy thought that by doing what he was doing, he thought that he would destroy my mother and take out any future family. But what the enemy thought that was going to absolutely destroy her, God had another plan. She would birth 4 children, one of them being a minister, all 4 loving Jesus. 23 grandchildren that love Jesus, now some going into the missionary field. Great grandchildren, I'm losing count. I think she has too. But when we all get together, we get in a circle and we circle up and we pray. And we always thank God that our family is alive and well and we all love Jesus. When one person in the family is having problems, we all have it. One niece, one nephew, one grandchild, whatever it is. When one has a problem, we all get around it. We rebuke this in the name of Jesus. It stops right here. Ladies, mothers, as we play this song, I'm going to open up the altars. And I want you to just take your hearts right now and focus. Whatever you've been through, whatever you've gone through, whatever problems are in your home or with your children, and you're trying to make restoration of that, even your grandkids, you're still a mom and you're a grandmom. There's been lots of breaches spiritually. And today, let's repair the breaches. Let's take it back before the Father. And allow the Father to be able to do the repairs in your life. Will you do that? As I pray, I'm going to pray, and they're going to play some music. And then you're all just, boy, bless you after the music is gone, you can leave. And then I want you to go out and do something today to help make those repairs, whatever they are, whatever they are. Praise the Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray, Lord God, for every mother that is here today, that there, Lord God, would be absolute restoration in the family. I pray, Lord God, for the families here where the enemy has wanted to destroy them. We rebuke it in the name of Jesus. We ask, Lord, that you will come into this thing and completely, Lord God, unite them and make them strong. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. If God is for me, who can be against me? We rebuke, Lord God, anything that would wipe out Mother's Day today. This is going to be a day where the mothers have victory. This is a day where the mothers, again, pull their families back together. We're grandmothers today. Claim a victory over their families. No more letting the enemy in. No more believing the lies. We now believe the truth, and the truth being Jesus Christ. Have mercy on us, O God, just like she cried out, Lord God, in Scripture. Have mercy on us. We don't deserve it, but Lord, we know we need it. Take care of us today, God. We ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. We're going to play a song. Listen to this song all the way through. The altars are open for you. Let's have victory today. Will you do that? Victory today. Let's pray today while this song's going on.
I can see the waters raging at my feet. I can feel the breath of those surrounding me. I can hear the sound of nations rising up. We will not be